But then, okay, let's talk about the Newton law. Newton's law. It has the first, second, and third law, right? Okay, forces, we talk about first one, we talk about what can it do? Okay, what can forces do? The second one, what can it do? And what kind of forces? Okay, then we talk about the effect is there, the forces itself is there. Okay, so let's jam them up all together. Okay, so let's do this math first. Okay, Newton, what can a force do? Let's do this first. Three things, okay? Tell me three things.
Start something moving.
Yep.
Then stop something moving and change its velocity.
Is your phone my phone? No. Your phone, okay. The first one is to give you translation, right? Translation means that you have give you accelerations, you can move, okay? Or even you can orbiting around, okay? It's always moving and moving along certain directions. So this is all methods of translations. So two more.
Rotational.
Yes, good, rotations. Now rotation is not talking about orbiting, okay? Orbiting is translation. You're going around with something. It's actually a lot of infinite straight line kind of things. Okay, rotation means self rotate. Okay, self rotate. So that's rotation. That one. Guess.
Both.
Sorry.
Both. Together.
Yeah, both. Okay, so one and two. Okay, but there's another three. The third one, not about translating, not about rotation, but if you apply a force, this thing happen also. Three things.
Destruction.
You're right, okay? Something like that. It's always that deformations. Okay? So, very clear, we learn three things, okay? Translations, rotation, and deformations. The most familiar one are translations. Okay? You've been done from set 2, okay? Or even set 1, the kind of things, all the way to there. Rotation, you start your rotations learning from set 3, set 4. Set 3, 4 at a time?
Does this include motion in circle?
No, motion in circle is translation. Okay, so this is why, right, translations, you have learned some basic translation in your primary school, and then some basic straight line translation in your secondary school, and then you learn some parabolic motions in secondary school also, in JC also. Then you do some differentiation in your AMAX also, right? Finally, come to A level at the time, they go a bit further, and they keep developing like motion in the circle, that kind of thing, circular motion and such. They are still translation, but they are advanced topic of translation. Okay, rotation, I'm not orbiting about it, I'm self-rotating. Okay, you have start learning rotation things from sec 4. That is moment, right? Rotation effect, moment, right? So that is actually the first thing about moment. Okay, so you only learn, this is just the beginning you've learned. Okay, deformations, what do we learn? Do you learn any deformations? For example, actually you learn, you just don't know me.
Springs.
Yes, spring, good, okay. So, you have touched something about force in deformations, right, in spring. Elasticity, those things. Rubber, glass, they'll break and this and that. And then the spring can stretch and compress, the kind of things. But these are deformation, okay. So,
isn't stretching and compressing translation?
No, not really, it's not moving, right? Okay, it's not moving, okay. So deformation, a change of shape or work done in object, work done on an object. Okay, so this is deformation. But actually, so mainly is these three. These two are the new things. So you learn some very basic things. Okay, and this one you learn one in sec 4. It's talked about principal mode, right? So these are three things that you can do. Okay. But secondly, what kind of forces can you have in the whole universe? In the whole universe, yeah.
Oh, contact force also.
I went through those things already.
Did I? Yeah, I still see them.
Contact force and contactless force and those things?
No, we never say it.
How come?
That's not you asked to say them.
Sorry?
You're asking a question, is it?
Yes, I'm asking what kind of forces can you exist in the world. Yeah, you're right. I thought it sounds like I taught you before. Contact force. No, it's not for me, right?
First lesson of forces.
Okay. It's not for me, right?
No.
Okay, good. Okay. The first kind, okay, the first kind is contact force. Contact forces. Okay. The second kind is
orientation.
Yep, there are field forces. The third kind is guess. And then you have the fourth kind. And the mysterious fifth kind till today, this is still a mystery.
Magnetic forces field.
Field, yeah. Good. But the fifth kind, right, which is today still a mystery, is nuclear force. Okay, but this is totally or absolutely not in the syllabus, okay?
Isn't nuclear force just
shampoo? No. Not really. Till today, they still don't know they're still arguing what is the origin of nuclear force. The reason is that proton is very small, right? Proton compared to atoms, right? Okay, atoms are very, very small, okay? But atom size, if the atom size is a soccer field size, right? Just ratio it, right? Then the atom, then the nucleus itself actually is the size of a soccer ball in soccer field, right? Think about a gold atom, you have 200 of the 50, is it 50 over or 60 over, I don't know, okay? You have many, many protons, they're all positive, right? They can be all squeezed inside one soccer ball, whereas the rest of the negative got to spread around the whole soccer field, expand as much as they can, right? So what is that force that go against all these positive and bind them until so small? There must be something that's binding them together. Okay? So they don't know, currently they just treat as nuclear force. Okay? So this is still under mystery, they're still arguing, is it the electric? Is it the magnetic? Is it the gravitation, because they're so close to one another? Then finally, until today, they still, maybe some people believe it's another type, other than all three, these three, okay? I don't know why my pastor keeps saying that that's Jesus. So I say, ooh, okay, that's a bit interesting. Okay, but if we keep finding these kind of things, right, I think we can really discover something in our world, a very original things, which is more than a positive, more than, because it goes against positive rule, it doesn't look like gravitation, because it's going to have a hard mass, okay? And then it is certainly more not magnetic because there's no north south there in the within a proton of a nucleus. Because from the electron we also know that there's no such things. So how long proton can? Okay. So it's still mystery, okay? Don't care about it. Okay. Two more. Guess? Or did I miss out something that you said?
Non-contact.
Yeah, they cannot be the contact force. They cannot be any more field force.
Elastic.
Good, okay. Tension, compression. Okay? One more. Think about it, okay? It's actually something that you've experienced before. It's something called the contact force also. Okay? But nothing to do with solid.
Viscous force.
You're right, okay. Fluid force. Okay? Any more other force? No more, okay? In the whole world, you can only have all these forces. Okay? In the contact force, you only have two. What are the two contact forces?
Normal
reaction force, you're right.
Friction.
Friction, okay. The friction formula, F less than equal to mu N. Okay? Now, I explain the friction. This is friction, okay? Now this formula is not needed, but just for understanding, because you don't know how to know more. Lesser than equal to because it's lesser than or equal to. Mu is the roughness of the surface, we call it coefficient of friction. N is the normal contact force. Reason? Okay, there is, of course there's a magnetic force, okay? But let's imagine that this is, let's imagine this is gravitational force, okay? Oh, no. Don't care about what force it is, okay? Now, you have some force that you touch this. When I push, right, there's some friction, right? Okay, so what if I press it harder, and then push it, you know that the friction increase, dependent on the amount of push I have, okay? So therefore, you know that the normal, the frictional force you have, right, is more or less dependent on the normal reaction force, feels like pressed in, your friction will also go harder. Okay? So this is why it is this. This is a coefficient of friction, so that means it's the roughness of surface experience, right? More rough, you got higher friction. More smooth like butter, like that, lesser friction. Okay? Why is that lesser than and equal to this? Okay? Just do this, okay? For example, if I push a little bit, and the object is not sliding because of friction, right? So when object is not sliding means that it's not moving left, it's not moving right. Okay? So it's not moving left, not moving right means my force is balanced by the friction. Okay? So, but then now I push in this way, I push in this way, it still don't move. So what does that mean? That means my friction could equal my force again. But just now, this force, right, the two forces are different. So what happened to two frictions? Two frictions have different value. If not, you have an acceleration sliding, either that side or this side. Okay? That means my friction, right, can take in any value, but maximum is mu n. Because if I keep pushing higher, someday I can slide it. The time that I can about to slide it, right, my force is roughly equal to mu n already. So the friction is always try to balance me. Okay? And then it can no longer balance because of coefficient of friction and the normal reactions, I can start to push over. Okay? When the object is moving, that I'm able to push it, the friction has reached the maximum it can have, which is mu n. Okay? So don't always say that the friction is equal to certain value. Okay? Friction is always equal to its maximum when object starts to slide or already slide. Okay? So if the maximum you can have is 4 newton, okay? So long I push anything less than 4 newton, my friction will equal to my force. Because my friction will not try to make this move to me. Okay? But if I push more than 4 newton, I will have a resultant force that way. Whatever force I apply minus 4 newton divided by the mass, we call acceleration. So this is friction lesser than equal to mu n. Okay? For understanding, okay? Don't have to remember because it's not your syllabus. But one thing for sure is that remember two things. Friction is not fixed value unless it's moving. If it's moving, all the instances of moving have the same value. Okay? Which is the maximum amount, okay? Which depends on mu n. So that's friction. Okay, so that's a value of friction. Value of normal reaction, no issue. Okay, but sometimes when they combine both of them, right, they call it the reactional force. Okay, reaction force or reaction low force. Okay, that means it's a combined consideration of both of them. Okay, that means they want to combine them and treat it as if it's one force. Okay,
but result vector is it?
Yes, you're right. So let's talk about this force first. Okay, all this I think. Okay, forces. Interesting. Okay. So, for example, right, if you have a object, okay, slanted and put on a floor which is rough. Okay, so when you touch, right, you have two forces. It's a normal reactions, which is going to be normal to the surface, and then you have a frictional force. Okay. Which is along the surface. But sometimes when they combine these two, the trees, there is a reactional force. Also can, okay? So actually these two resolve will give you this. Or this one can break down to these two. It doesn't matter. Okay? Sometimes they want to treat as one, you can also consider them separately. Okay? So remember this reactional force. If you have reactional force, all the contact force that will give you a reaction force is not a Newton's third law reaction force, even if you use the same name. Okay? I'm not talking about Newton's third law there. Action and reaction, no. Okay, I'm talking about contact force. If you treat these two as one contact force, it's sometimes called a reaction force. Okay? And this is actually normal plus friction. Okay? 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 Good. Okay? So when two objects touch, you only have these two. About touching, it's only about these two. Okay? So tell me. Okay, this one is on a balance, let's say. Okay, something like that. Is the force that pushing this W? Yes or no?
No, what is W?
W means weight.
Half.
Weight of the person. Yes or no?
Is it half W?
Half W? Why even go half W? I'm going to say that. Does it make sense to call it W?
No.
No. Because it is a? What force?
Gravitation force.
It's a gravitation force, right? It's a what force? What do you think? What's the nature of this force?
The arrow.
Yes, this arrow.
It's
isn't that it's a force that this foot will add on the balance? That's what I'm talking about. Okay, assume that this guy only have one leg, okay? Yeah, okay. Then this force. Is this weight? No, right? Reason?
It's compression force.
It's compression force.
On the floor.
Okay. Now, the reason is it is a normal pressure force. Okay? Because it's a contact force. The leg touch the floor. Okay? It's a leg, it's a front wheel, it's a shoelace. Okay? So, this force, right, is by the foot on the floor. And let's say it's not about balance, okay? On the floor. So, it exists because the foot touched the floor. I know it's down, okay? Right? So it is a touching force. If it's a touching force, it is a normal reaction force. Okay?
Why is weight?
Why is it not weight? Okay? Weight is defined as the gravitational pull from the earth to the person. Okay?
So I see me and here. No weight.
Not with it. There is a weight here, but certainly this is not weight. Okay? This is not weight. Because firstly, this is not from the earth to the person.
The normal contact force is up.
Normal contact force is up, yeah. Direction, I'll talk to you later, okay? But normally, except for the time you see this kind of diagram, right? Everybody just put a weight there, right? And then you calculate it's correct, right? Okay, but now it's no longer correct, okay? This is not weight, okay? Reason one, this is a contact force. Reason two, the weight is by who on who? By earth. On the person, right? Okay, let's not talk about by earth. It is on that person. But this force, right, is a force on?
Feel the ground.
On the ground, on the floor. It's not a force on the person. It's on the floor, okay? So therefore, this cannot be a weight. Because weight is supposed to be by the earth and it's at the person, on the person, okay? So last time, how come we just anyhow put a W there? We have a lot of assumptions.
Newton's third law.
Yes, Newton's third law and Newton's second law also. Both need. Okay. I'm going to come back to here, but let's talk all together, okay? So, why is that so, right, is that because you talk about the force on the person, okay, this person, one leg only, okay? You talk about force on a person, there's only two, okay, which is the weight. Which is the weight? Downward. It's an earth pull. E11 on this guy, okay, so downward pull. Okay? But another force on this person is the normal reaction force, which is upward. By the floor, on his foot. Just now the force is by the foot, on the floor. So, to the floor, right, you have this one's mirror image, okay, which is the Newton's third law, okay. But because this fellow, if it is in equilibrium, either in constant speed, constant velocity, that means direction and both speed must be constant, or zero velocity, it's not moving, okay. Then N is equal to W, okay. According to Newton's third law, these two are equal. Therefore, this thing will be the W, okay, numerically. Can see it? So this is not weight unless this zero this. Okay? So can I have an instance that this is not your list? Of course. When you're falling with accelerations, okay, then your resultant force, right? Your resultant force equal to M, your resultant force equal to MA, which is you have accelerations, which is equal to the downward, which is W, minus away the N, right? So therefore, the n, right, you have, right, is w minus ma. Well, that means the n is lesser than the w, if you're falling down. Okay? So that means, right, this didn't third law says this got to be equal to this in all case. But this n prime also got to be less than w. So there are instances that this n prime, which is not w anymore. Okay? So that means, right, it cannot be the weight. Because if this the weight, in all cases, it got to equal to the weight. Okay? There is a case that this is not the same as this value. Okay? So we say this are equal because of the second law and the third law. Such thing that. Okay? So remember this is not weight. Okay? So make your mind very clear. They come back to some basic things. I love this color, but this is hope. Okay, so come back to here. We talk about it's actually very easier to put it this way. Remember, anything n two things touch, there's only two force. One is normal reactions, and one is frictional force.
But if object is like that way.
Yeah, sorry. Wait. Something must be holding here and there.
But it's holding, then there's a finger push. Then there's a force.
Maybe I'm the guy that holding this thing, hanging there on the floor for you to see here. Okay, but you don't know the rest of the thing. Okay,
is there a force from the top to the bottom? For example,
that can be. It can be. But let's talk about here. Let's talk about this here, where they touch. When two things touch, we have contact force, normal reaction and frictions. I don't know the rest. Okay? You may have weight or you have something, but who cares? Those things later. And then when two things touch at this surface, there's only two force, normal reaction and frictions. Okay? Okay, so let's talk about normal reaction first. Okay. So let's say I have a ladder. Okay. This ladder leaning on a wall. This is a floor. Okay? Let's talk about normal reaction purely, okay? So, which is the normal reaction force that is on the ladder, okay? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, okay? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay? Which is the force that is by wall or ladder?
To resultant.
No, it cannot be resultant force. Resultant force means
You are talking about
the normal two
perpendicular lines that force.
No, I'm talking about the normal force at this contact surface.
Two,
right? You?
Two or one?
Two, right? Okay. By ladder on wall?
One,
right? Okay? So I think no issue, okay? You can understand, okay? If this is object A, this is object B, okay? The surface towards object A1 is on A, okay? Towards B1 is on B, okay? But I must buy another guy, okay? So it's very simple. So let's talk about friction, okay? So friction, F1, F2. Okay? F1 is on who? F1 is 4 on ladder.
The ladder is like moving to the left.
So this is on ladder, right? What do you think?
Yeah,
also, right? How do you know?
The ladder will move there if there's no friction.
Yes, that's the way to be the case. What if it is moved? What if it is moved, it will slide to the left? And because it is not sliding to the left, the frictions is actually heading to the right. Okay, so how to predict frictions? Very simple. Just tell yourself, what if it is moved compared to what is this instant? Then you know the roughness of the surface, how to have the actions. Okay, now take a look at this. When you're riding a bicycle, okay. I don't know. Okay, whatever it is, you brake. In a very fast instance, you brake. Okay? Where must be the frictions at the instant that you start to brake? Direction of friction is No, of course you're moving
direction.
This way. This way. Correct?
I think so.
Correct. Is it? Correct? Hey, because the idea is, how do you say
when
that?
When you're moving.
When you're breaking.
Yeah.
Okay, because what if it is smooth, right? You can't break. Because it's rough, you can break. So the force is, the friction must be helping you to break. Okay? No, if you're riding a single wheel bicycle, okay?
Wait, if you're, when you're moving, right, the friction is which direction?
Okay, it's the same.
Well, no, we must talk about when you're moving, so.
When you're moving forward, when you're riding a bicycle, you haven't braked yet.
Yeah, interesting.
Turning.
Okay, let's do this. When you're running, when you're riding on a single wheel bicycle, when you're riding forward, okay?
Friction
when you're riding
right.
forward, where's the direction of friction? Left or right?
Left.
You say left, right? You?
If you don't do anything, it will go to the right. It won't go to the right, but it will slow down.
So left or right?
It should be left.
Okay, let's talk about when I start to ride. From stationary, I start to ride. Friction is left or right?
Right.
This is wrong. Okay, it's left. Okay? The reason is, what if this move? If it's smooth, it cannot move. Right? So now, because it's rough, it can move. So therefore, the friction is helping him to move.
But now you see the direction of the turning.
Direction of the turning. How do you, what
now
do you mean?
You is rotating anti-clockwise. So the friction will be opposing the movement.
Hmm. You can think in that way. Okay? You can think in that way. But can I give you a counter example? Now, in this case, when you're braking, right?
The wheels are stopped really.
No, wow, you don't break until like that. Yeah. When you're braking at time, the wheel is still rotating in that way, what? Your prime brake only, right? You just lower down your rear only. It's still rotating in that way. Okay? No, I'm sorry, say that your exact imagination is correct. If you go to the extreme case, you will be able to deduce it. Okay? But these kind of small mechanical things and the relative speed and this and that, right? It will be a bit complicated. Okay? So there is, in case you cannot deduce it, convince yourself. Then use an easier way to deduce it, like what if it is smooth? Okay, because what if it is smooth will give you the overall effect of your whole thing. Okay? So because it's rough, what happened? Then you know what happened to the friction. Okay? That's an easier way for it. Okay? But you are correct. Okay? The idea is that even though I slow down the time, that means that the relative speed of this is actually slower than the relative speed of this. So actually it's the same thing as you're going backward. So this is why the friction is that way, this way. Okay, but you've got to talk about all this relative speed and such. Okay, not easy, okay, but anyway, now you know how to predict the frictions.
So for the mono, the one,
yeah.
One bicycle,
yeah.
If it's smooth, it will move them, but why you know that the friction is on to the left?
If it is smooth, it will move, right?
Yeah.
Because it's rough, it move.
Mm-hmm.
So actually, the friction is helping him to move. When there's no friction, he cannot move.
Uh-huh.
So the friction is giving an acceleration in that way.
Oh.
Yeah, thinking that way is easier. Okay. Okay, any problem for the friction and the normal relations? Okay, so that's all about a contact force. Okay, let's talk about the next force. Okay, the second force is the, what's the force? The field force, okay? Field forces will cover in their individual chapter because it's quite cheap. Let's go through it, okay?
Is it gravitational?
Gravitational, yep. Gravitational video I already uploaded, okay? Of course, I can still give you the same lecture, don't worry about it, okay? But take a look, okay? It's a very fast 20 minutes lesson, okay? Gravitational force, okay, F equal to minus G mm over R square. Okay, you know what I mean, right? Okay?
No.
Okay.
We haven't done this chapter
yet. Oh, doesn't matter. Very simple, okay? I don't teach you the rest yet. If now Newton's third law says, when a force have A on object B, right? Okay, will equal to minus force of B back to point A, right? It is the third law, right? Okay. So when a force, when you have gravitational pull on one planet from another planet, okay, actually there's an equal opposite pull from this planet back to this planet, and that's on this formula. Okay.
So this pull caused the planet to move, right?
This pull caused
the star to stay.
Yes and no, okay? This pull actually caused the things to fall towards one another. Okay?
But the sun will move.
Yeah. Sun maybe the sun is actually rotating. Actually maybe all of us are rotating in the respect to the center of mass of the whole universe.
Oh.
Okay? So we see that we're orbiting around the sun, right? It actually may not be the case. Okay? It may not be the case. Because you say I'm rotating about this. Okay, this is a simple model. But actually, right, if these two are in with the center of gravity, center of mass getting the average point is roughly here, right? That means actually both are rotating about here only. Okay, but it looks like as if it is like that. You take this as not moving. Actually, they may be actually rotating this way, and actually the whole thing may be rotating as another thing. Okay, we don't know what is the center of mass of the whole universe. And I don't know why the world of rotational axis in that way. Why not like that? Why not like that? Why not like that? How do we know in three-dimensional world it's not a two-dimensional thing?
The distance is a constant.
Sorry?
The distance between Earth and Sun.
Distance between Earth and Sun, is it constant? No. You sure it's constant? You sure it's a perfect circle?
If it's somewhat constant, then you will be like rotating about one about another.
No, but the point is that the worst thing is that even all the planets are not perfect sphere. They are all ellipse. But the Earth is not sphere, it's actually ellipse. Bianda. So if we talk about bianda things, right, is it really a perfect circle, the orbit? You know, if the orbit is a circle, then the orbit is ellipse. Okay? But for simplicity, from primary school, teach those kids, you know, for any for us to know, we just treat as a circle, perfect circle. Yeah. So is that really true? Then you may think about it. Because I know that there is adjustment. That means there are instances that the Earth is closer to something. There are instances that something is closer and something further away from something. Okay. So I don't know. Okay, let me know. Okay. didn't spend time. Okay. Anyway. Just to tell you what is this. Okay? So. If you talk about this one, normally we refer to the force on the big M. Okay?
Big M is what?
Big M is either one of them. Big M. Okay?
Oh.
Because when we talk about gravitational field, it says that okay, I am the field provider and you are the object of influence by me. Okay? In for us it's simple, right? We are human being on Earth. So Earth is the big M and me is the small M. Okay? There is a gravitational pull from the Earth on me, actually there is also a gravitational pull that from me on Earth, I'm actually pulling the Earth up also. Okay, he's pulling me down, okay, those kind of things. Okay? But okay, so this is the mutual thing. So the field provider is called a big M. The one that in this case you treat as an object, actually both can, okay? We call it M. And the force is defined as the force from the small M to big M. Negative because it goes against the radiating positive directions. Okay, if you radiate a field, right, you talk about I radiate a field, then you say, okay, so let's define something. So your field want to go out or in, I radiate, then of course I say outward. Okay, so then secondly you say, okay, let's stick to a symbol, positive. For human beings, you say, oh, positive. So this is why they define outward as positive. Okay, but then this is going against my outward positive, so this is why we have a negative sign here. And the negative sign, it shouldn't be calculated in the calculations because this that it just tells you the direction. Once you draw it out, and it's a vector, so you've got to draw all this triangle, right? You can drop the minus. Anyway, this M, G is a universal gravitational constant. Okay? It's the gravitational constant.
Right.
Sorry?
Non-directional.
Which one?
9.81.
No, it's 9.81. This is 9.1. Mg. Yeah, R, if it was on Earth, right, you will take the radius of the Earth.
Oh.
So it's roughly we treat as a circle, so this one we have one constant 9.1. Okay? Because the mass of Earth and radius of Earth is just put inside. But if it's the planet like that, it's very different. Okay? So mm, and center of mass, this distance is the r. Okay? The distance between the center of mass is the r. And so this is gmm over r squared for gravitational force. Okay? You don't worry, you will be taught in very detail the gravitational force whole chapter. Okay? We just know the field force, first one, gravitational force. The second force is called, the second force is called the electric force. And electric force is similar to gravitational force. We have F equal to QQ over 4 pi epsilon not R squared. Okay? It's the same, but this constant now become 1 over 4 pi epsilon not only. Some permeability of air, some stuff. Find it from the constant symbol, 4 pi of it, okay? But actually it's still
Q is what?
Q is a charge.
Not the mass of the particle or something?
No, not the mass. Because it's electric force, right? Total due to how many charge you have. You have small particle have many charge. You have big particle doesn't have much charge. Okay? It's only the charge dependent. Okay, so this is an attraction force, okay? If it is positive, how many coulomb put positive? Negative, how many coulomb put negative? Then the force will tell you whether this is a positive or negative force. Repel or attract. Okay? Then the R, right, is just the center of charge also. Okay? Center of charge means the center point of all the charges. Okay? If it is a perfect circle with six charges like that, then of course the center of charge is the center. Okay? Then yeah, just get a center of charge. So this is R. And so this is QQ force.
So the charge is about one particle, right?
It's charged on the object. Okay, your object can be a metallic sphere.
So the center of, so the R thing is taken from the center of mass of the
center of charge. Center of charge depends on mass. I'm sorry, center of charge depends on shape, not the mass. Okay, if now for example one sphere, okay, half made with lead, and another half made with aluminium. Center of mass is roughly here, will not be a center. But if you allow the charge to expel one another, it may not be affected by the mass. So it may still be at the center. It depends on the shape, actually.
But AL is 3 plus.
Yeah, but I'm not talking about the outermost cells electron you have. You pump extra electron. What if you make the whole sphere with a lot of negative charge on top of it? It's not chemistry, eh? Compared to physics. Okay? That means a metallic sphere, I make it negative charge by putting more electron in it, the kind of things. And then we have one another center of charge to the center. So careful is the center of the charge between the two particles. But don't worry, this one will still be covered inside electric force, okay? It's still one whole big chapter. Of course, magnetic is the same thing, okay? We will still cover the whole magnetic chapter, but just let you give you a preview. Magnetic force, okay, the force amount have two formula, which is going to be IL. And
magnetic.
Equal to BQB.
Okay.
BIL is the magnetic force on a rod. Charge is current carrying rod. Current with I, with some B field. Okay. Then you have FBI this way. No, force is generated this one. Okay, so B is this, I is this, so the force is left. So this is the force on the whole rod, okay? So you use this model. Okay, for charged particle, it is BQV. Okay, BQV, if you have an electron moving in one direction, okay? So if you enter a magnetic field into the paper, okay? You have a magnetic force also, okay? So we treat the current opposite to the direction of electrons, okay? I take this one, B in the paper, I like that, so the F is like that. Okay, but this F will need to adjust according to your velocity. So your electron will spin in circle. Okay? But all this will be covered in the magnetic field chapter. Okay, it's just to let you know that there is some way to calculate the magnetic force. Okay? Let's finish this one. Okay, this is contactless force. Okay. I'm sorry, this is a field force, okay? Contact force, field force, right? Third one is called tension and compression. I didn't bring this to your attention is that for you to know the real tension and compression, which is very different from what you learned last time. Okay, if you talk about tension, I have a string. The tension should be the tension in the string. Make sense? Okay? If I have a spring, the tension is tension experienced by the spring. Make sense? Make sense, right? Okay, good. If I have a pendulum on wall, which is swinging halfway this way, people draw this tension, right? But this tension is tension on who? On the ball or on the string?
On the line.
On the ball, right? Because we say this is the W, there is the T, then resolve, resolve. Why are we resolving? Because it's all on the ball. This is not the tension. The value is equal. Okay? So when we have a lot of systems like this, okay, mounted on the wall, that kind of things, right? Okay? Okay. Those kind of zhao pai, fa tai, okay? Fa. Okay? Those kind of zhao pai. We have a lot of problem on the force at the joint versus force in the rod. Joint and rod are different. Last time and most of the time we are interested in joining the forces on the joint. This is the joint actually. But we are not actually talking about the force in the string itself. Okay? And I'm going to tell you that tension and compressions is actually the force inside the string. We don't talk about this outside force, which is equivalent to the inside force. Okay? So
which direction is the tension?
Yeah, good. Okay. According to the third law, this is the tension.
Two ways.
Yes, there's always two ways. So this one tension compression, they try not to teach you because it's very confusing. Why is it confusing? Like this. If you have a string, I'm experiencing tension. How does it experience tension? Don't you think it is like that? Tension, right? Okay. Your girlfriend pull your face, okay? So you experience tension in both. So the idea is that if tension equal T, equal 10 Newton, what does that mean? This means, right, this is 10 Newton. Make sense?
The other side.
10 Newton also. So does it mean that you are experiencing 20 Newtons of tension? No. Okay, this is why they don't teach tension, because tension is actually a very interesting force that which is very confusing. Okay, when you go and pull your face in this way, your face will move from right to left. So it could come with a pair, so that you don't have a resulting force, that you will not move right or left. Okay. On the other hand, if your girlfriend stable your face at the wall there and then pull you another side, you're also not moving. Okay. So there is a pull in this one, obviously 10 Newton, but there must be another force that balances this pull, which is the stable on your face on the wall, okay, which is the tension pull you another side. So however, whether they add one side is 10 Newton, that will give you automatic 10 Newton and outside if you pin it on the hole, pin it on the wall, okay? Fix it on the wall. Or, should pull it both ways with 10 Newton, it's the same effect. So, pull one side 10 Newton is equivalent to pull both sides 10 Newton. It's the same thing. And this is the first confusing thing about tension. Secondly, these two forces cancel one another, yes. But it is experiencing 10 Newton of tension, that's what I say. Got it? So, it is, okay? Once it's proper tension, it's always in terms of couple, a pair. They cancel one another. You say 10 Newton of tension means 10 Newton both sides. So if you have an object, let's say at the ring is fixed on the wall, and the ring, right, the ring, let's say, fixed on the wall, and then you have this one tightened at the ring there, and then another side, the string, you pull this one 10 Newton, okay? For the string itself, actually have 10 Newton left, right? Okay? But you will add, according to third law, right? If you have these things, this thing is by who on who? This thing is by this hook on the string. Okay? So according to third law, at this instant, the string will add an equal opposite 10 Newton to the hook. This is why, if you talk about the hook will just experience 10 Newton of tension. But this tension is coming from the tension of the string. Okay? In these directions. Because at this junction, direction of tension is opposite directions, which is by the hook on this string, so not by the string, by the hook. Understand this? Okay. When the trouble comes, there are some super MCQ with this kind of tension compression. You must go into very detail of this. It's all about the rods and the joints. For example, if have a road system, have some zhao pai, okay? So on the wall, the kind of things, okay? If this is all solid things, right? These three forces, okay, must be in the, these three forces, you can resolve either these things internal or you resolve at the joint there. Okay, if you talk about the joint there, okay, you have weight, right? And see, this is like that. So, let's have a zhao pai. Let's have two zhao pai. Then you have this, and then you have this, let's say. Okay, so that will be balanced. You talk about here, right? Okay, you will think that what is the thing that you're experiencing here? You think that what if it is elastic? What will happen to be pulled, right? Because these are the weight. Okay, these are the weight. Okay, so this is a pull, right? So the tension inside here is like that. Right? Okay, but to the joint, right, that will be like that. Okay? Correct? Because this is by the pole or the joint. Okay? So, if you have a component, this right, you need a component to the right. So therefore, right, you know that there is one guy going to give you a force in this way or this way. Right? Because you need a right side component. Okay? But if you say that this is the... No.
Why can't the right side be a horizontal line?
Sorry? But this one can only give you this or this, so it's going to be along the line.
Oh.
So you have two more forces, either this way or this way, and this way or this way. Okay? It cannot be this and this, because you need upper components. Okay? It cannot be this and this, because you need a downward component. So it's either this or this. You cannot have this, because these are both to the left. Nothing will balance with this left. So the only answer is this and this and this. For this three. And once you know this is the force at the joint, you know this one is experiencing compression, because it's going to be equal opposite. Okay? And then, since, I know it's confusing, okay? So since this joint here going to have a force in this way, okay? So therefore, the inside this rod here must have at this side must have an opposite one. So it must be this way and this way. So it must have a tension. But this one must be a compression. Okay? Then you keep using the whole structure and using that. Okay? So don't have to come so complicated, just remember internal is normally what we neglect. We only care about what happened to the hook, not inside. And we abuse it by saying this is tension. Just the same amount of what you experience inside. Got it? So this is why we have T, W. Okay? We don't care about the thing inside the string. Okay, because the string inside is having tension this way. So therefore, at this spot here, is actually equal to opposite. Okay? And that is the same way of tension. Okay, I'm going to do the third law. Got it? Okay, tension compression. Okay, so what are the four forces?
Fluid
force.
Is it like?
Sorry?
Ultras.
You're right, okay? Fluid force got how many type?
Viscous.
Yeah. The first one is called ultras. The second one is called viscous force or drag force. Okay, there's only two. Okay, and actually, what is this thing? Actually, it is kind of things like contact force. Okay, but it is in liquid or fluid. Okay, in fluid. Okay, we want to talk about. We want to talk about what happened when. Sorry, air is a fluid. Okay, so gas, liquid, is fluid, solid is we use the normal reaction and friction. They actually have the same idea. Is that if you have an object. Okay. Touch a solid surface, you have normal reactions, and you have frictions, right? Okay? If you have this object deep into the water, okay, you have up thrust, okay, and if you need a frictions, then you have a fluid frictions, okay? So this is drag force, this up thrust, okay? So don't need to doubt about so what's a normal reaction force when this one touch liquid? No, this is actually renamed as up thrust, okay? Because it's not just touch the surface, you can sink in some more. Okay, so it's a more complicated than this. And what is the what's the frictions that rub the surface? Okay, we don't rub the surface, we rub the whole liquid. Okay, so this is actually the drag force. Okay. Okay. Up thrust, easy. Formula. Up thrust equal to mg. Yeah. It's m times g. Okay? But it's different from the mg. It is like if you have an object, okay, half sink into the water, what's the up thrust? Okay? The up thrust will equal to you take out the sink in amount of your object, but then fill it with water. Fill it with a liquid.
That's up thrust.
Okay? Then this is M prime. Time G. So for this weight, right, of the displaced water filled with fluid will be the up thrust you experience upward. Okay? So this is not dependent much on your mass and the mass distribution. It's more depends on the shape that you occupy in the liquid. Okay? So that is up thrust. And prime G, I just remember it. But there is an easier one, they say we roll G. Right? We use the wheel of object that it occupies the liquid. Okay? Rho is the density of water because V times rho, density of water, actually is the mass. Okay? Mass, G. So they use V rho G. Up thrust equal to V rho G. Okay? I love this pen. It's nice. Okay, drag force, last one. Okay, drag force is very complicated because it depends on the cross-sectional shape against the fluid, okay? So this is why if you have a sphere go through a stream of fluid, if you have a rectangle going through the fluid, all the formulas are different, okay? But roughly tell you something. There's something called laminar flow. There's something called turbulence flows. Okay? Laminar flow means you have an object that the fluid comes into you, right? Can still remain as a streamline. Okay? Turbulence flow means that we have an object that's flow inside the things, right? Will give you some non-streamline turbulence of curl of air. How to see all this curl of air whatsoever? If you add a lot of smoke particle in the air. Okay, for example the jet engine, if they have some smoke come out, like how they play during the NDP at the time, when they pass by, you see the flow of the fluid because smoke particle is inside the air. So when air curl, you can see the smoke curl also. But it's easier if you go to science center, they demonstrate inside liquid, okay, inside water. They just put a lot of small white particle inside. When the streamline flow the time, you see the particle line up and curl and such things. Okay, so those are flows, okay? So when it's a laminar flow, right? When it's a laminar flow, your drag force is proportional to velocity. Okay? When there's turbulent flows, right, your drag force is proportional to the square of your velocity. Okay? Just like that, okay? Maybe just put a K there. One of the formula is 6 pi nRV. 6 pi nRV. Okay, this is for a sphere. Not in syllabus, but they test. Okay, when they test you, they got to give you the formula. Okay, but they test you. Okay, because I see a lot of questions that they actually quote this and ask you to do this. Okay, it's good to know. Okay, when the airplane landing, the time. Okay, when time it breaks, right? And you know that how they how they open the wing downward, okay, to press the whole aircraft on the floor, and they try to brake, right? But when they start, when it's about to stop the time, right, they suddenly open up a small cap at both sides, suddenly open it up, upward, okay? And when the inside will open up at the time, the whole plane shake. Okay, but once it shake, right, very fast, it will totally stop. What's the use of this small wing that go up? It will make the laminar flow to a turbulence flow. Once it make the turbulence flow, the V square power will make it stop very fast. But the
inside the plane wing suddenly open up.
Yeah, the plane wing is like that, right? When it's landing, right, it will extend. Okay, so that it will press down the whole airplane. Okay, have a higher friction.
The tip go up.
Yes, at the end there, you suddenly have two small of that go up, go up like that. It suddenly open, but when the speed is lower, okay, then this one right will make a turbulence flow and make it a V square. Once you make a V square, right, it will stop very fast. But in expanded, it shakes a lot because of turbulence. Okay, so they don't open it too early because otherwise the whole thing keeps shaking, and it's breaking very fast. That's okay. Okay, turbulence, you have a lot of shaking with some patterns. You actually have a frequency of shaking, okay? But it's not good that the airplane keep jumping. But this way can cause a very great backward force and stop it. Okay, so that's something about drag force. And nuclear force, I think I've already said already. It's the force that binds the positive proton together in a such a small nucleus. Okay? And interestingly, if you disintegrate a nucleus by a little bit, right? All those positive particles will all split in a very fast way. Okay? Because they actually hate one another, they're all positive. Okay? And from the nuclear force, we don't learn about the nuclear force, okay? Because it's still not far. But inside here, we learn about nuclear potential energy, something like binding energy, and those things, mass defect. We find something called negative mass inside. Okay? Inside all the
matter.
It's not antimatter, it's a matter. That means it's not antimatter, but this matter inside has negative mass. Okay, you will learn about all these things in the quantum physics there. Okay. Okay, I finished all the forces. Okay, what are forces? Okay, what can a force do? Okay.
So rotation.
Yeah, so this now is that how to do rotational, okay? Rotational prism movement. Translation rotation. Okay, so now right when they give you a system, say they most of the time they don't draw all forces for you. Okay, they draw until certain forces are missing. And then all you need to do is just go through all the forces. So do you have contact? Do you have this? Do you have that? You check it all out. You will just draw the forces yourself. Let's talk about translational rotations. Okay, rotational world actually is a mirror image of a translational world. Whatever thing you have in translation, you have one similar quantity in the rotations. For example, the distance that you move is in meter, right? Okay? In the rotational world, we don't talk about meter, but we talk about angle, which is in radian or degree. Okay? Radian. Okay, let's say. Okay? That means I have traveled 4 meters. Okay? I have rotated pi radians. Okay? But that is the backing. Then you have velocity, right? Okay? You have a velocity which is a meter per second, right? Actually, on the same things, right, you have a rotational speed also. Okay? We just, in here, we are lazy. We just put a dot there. Dot means differentiation one time. Okay? Theta dot means differentiation one time of theta, respect time. So, this is in how many radian per second? Okay? Make sense? Okay, so if I have accelerations, which is meter per second square, okay, actually you have a theta double dot there. Okay, how many radian per second square? You never touch about this, okay, don't worry about it, okay. Then the next one, we have force, which is in Newton, right? Okay, in the force world property, we say is that in translation world, if an object is not moving, now not moving in the translation world means that when an object is not translating or under constant translation velocity, the left force, right force balance, right? Okay? But what do we talk about rotations? when the object is not rotating, we say what equal to what? What balance with what? Not left balance with right, up balance. Clockwise balance with anti-clockwise, right? But clockwise what? Balance with anti-clockwise what?
Clockwise rotation.
Clockwise what is the thing in clockwise? What's the word? Clockwise what? Equal to anti-clockwise what?
Torque.
Sorry? The torque. Or moments, right? Okay? Moment. Okay? When objects in equilibrium, force are balanced. When objects in equilibrium, the moments are balanced. So we have resultant force, right? We have resultant moment also. Okay? So the resultant moment, what happens if you have resultant moment? You start to able to accelerate rotationally. That means speed will be increasing, further and further. The rotation speed will increase further and further. Okay? So one more, mass. Okay, in kg. Okay, this one is called moment of inertia. Okay. Sorry, I can't remember these things already.
We are turning this inertia.
Sorry? Now there is something called moment inertia, which is actually the rotational mass. What's the mass in translation? What's the meaning of mass in translation? In terms of dynamics. Mass is
the substance.
Is no. In mass is actually indication of inertia. Right? Higher mass is more reluctant in change in motions, right? Okay? The fat guy hard to stop. The fat guy hard to start, okay? The thin guy easy to stop, easy to start, right? Why? Because FUMA. Okay? For the same amount of force, resultant force, higher the mass, smaller the A. Okay? So smaller A means smaller change in speed. Okay? So therefore, mass is actually kind of things like reluctant in change in translation velocity. Moment inertia also the same. It's a reluctant in change in rotational velocity. But I can't remember the unit. Okay.
Harder to stop, is it?
Harder to stop, okay. So
but mass is at a...
You're right, okay. Keep thinking. You're right. Now, here, we talk about moment. Force contributes to the moment, right? Higher force, you have higher moment. But you have a factor of the distance. So you actually have a force and a factor of a distance from rotational center. Make sense? By the moment you want to take it. Okay? So anyway, this is in. Okay, the force is in. So greater the force, greater the moment. Hello? Yes, I am. Madam, who is it? Yeah, the keyboard is clear. Uh-huh. Yeah. Okay, bye. Okay, bye. So in same thing, okay, the reluctance of change of rotational speed, right, should also have this as a factor. Mass is also inside MI, and to distance from the center of rotation is also inside this factor. Okay?
You're talking about one thing turning on itself, is it?
Yeah, turning on itself. It's not orbiting, okay? Yes.
Then where's the mass? The
mass is still the... No, the mass is... Different, okay? It's at the center, due to the center of gravity, right? The argument is what? The argument is that I can balance it with that one point. Make sense? Okay? That's the translation issue. But rotational issue is different. This rotation and this rotation, you see the amount of things you can swing, right, is different. Okay? One more example. Now, you don't have to go detail on this, but give you a feeling of it, okay? Remember when you do ice skating, okay? People do ice skating at the time, right? They are, initially they swing with their legs and arms, okay, widened, right? And then you see the rotational speed, right? So after that, what they do? They try to fold their arms, fold their legs until very close to the center of rotations. What happened? They realize that the swing speed is faster and faster and faster as much as they get close to them. This guy has the same mass, Okay? But in the rotational world, it's a little bit different because this guy has the plane. All the mass integrations, okay, from the, that is adding up all the mass from the center rotations to every part of mass that contributes. Okay, they are all contributed to MI. The higher it is, the higher the MI. Okay, the higher the MI. Okay, that means the higher moment of inertia. Okay, so what I will say is that if you have a huge object which is the mass is spread from the center of rotations, okay, with the same mass you get it very close to the center of rotations, okay, you have two properties. The one the very far away is hard to start rotating, but once it start, right, hard to stop. Okay, but the one that's very close to one point there is easy to rotate, but it's easy to stop also. Okay, it's not just about the center of mass anymore. It's a summation of all the mass with the multiplication of the distance of every part. That is the moment of inertia. Okay, but don't go into all this. Okay, so just to tell you that this accordingly. And what I'm going to do all this, because I know that we are an expert in this world. We're expert in this world. So what do we have? S equal to ut plus half at squared, right? I want to tell you, theta equal to theta dot initial t plus half theta double dot t squared also. Got it? FUMA, right? Resultant force, right? We have resultant moment equal to MI times theta double dot also. Kinetic energy, half MV squared, right? Half MI theta dot squared. It gives you the same amount of rotational kinetic energy. Got that? Okay, so whatever in the translational world, actually all happen in the rotational world. So if you hear something like, find the resultant moment of this system. No sweat, it's just to tell you something like resultant force. So you see the clockwise speaker or anti-clockwise speaker. If clockwise speaker is clockwise subtract any clockwise moment, that is the resultant moment. Okay? They just tell you the resultant moment is how much is clockwise. It's good enough as an answer. Okay? And they don't go into too deep. But if they go one more step, what is the angular acceleration? So tell them also FUMA. Okay? The kind of things. Okay, good. Okay, so that's the concept in the rotational world. Once you get this concept, you know you can answer a lot of questions. Okay, I ask you if I have an object rotating in constant angular velocity, okay, or every 5 seconds one round like that, it's keep like that. Okay, but there is two forces in here, clockwise and anticlockwise. What can you say? These two must be the same, right? Okay, because it's constant velocity, constant rotational velocity. But therefore, clockwise moment must still equal to anticlockwise moment. There's no rotational acceleration. Okay, so more than doing the static things. Okay, now, so now comes the check of those things. Okay, some example. Okay, when I have this kind of system, and if you have a fellow that when you have this kind of system, okay, we talk about what is the things that is not rotating. Define objects. Normally, define these things as object. Okay. So what are the forces on there? There are two quantum forces. One, two. Okay. There is one force. There's one force control, which is the wave. Okay. So three forces. The interesting thing is that if I want to find N1, okay, I give you the wave. I give you all the dimensions. Okay? You have two unknown. If you use the translation, right, this two add equal to this. Okay, you have two unknown one equation, you can't solve it. Okay? But the difference between translation resolving and rotational resolving, rotational has a trick. You take moment of this point, this force will not appear in your equation. Okay? Because moment equal to force times this perpendicular distance. When perpendicular distance goes zero, the whole thing goes zero. So this will go zero. So one unknown is gone, right? You can say this distance, this force, this distance, this force. Then you can equate it, and you realize that everything is known. This is known, can be found. And after you found this, do not do a dumb things like take one over this point and do the same thing again. No. Once you find this, equate this two with this one, straight away find it. Okay, so you spend some translation time, okay? Normally just do one time of moment, or do two times of moment.
For example, if you get the turning effect for this way and the weight, then how do we get the...
How do we get the N2, is it? N1 plus N2 equal to weight.
Oh, okay.
Right? Because translational is equivalent also. Okay? So don't do another time of moment, okay, unless it's very needed. Now, but we have some problem, okay? A lot of students have this problem, you too may not. Okay? Moments equal to force times perpendicular distance. Okay? And the concept of what is moment is actually a rotational force. Okay? Kind of like a force. Okay? So, moment of this distance, right? The distance is defined as from the force, okay? Actually from the axis of rotations to the force. This is the actual definitions. We also say take moment about pawn, right? Okay, we say take moment about pawn. Okay, become the no. We actually take moment about axis. Okay, that is the rotational axis. Because the rope, if you not want that rotation, you need one whole axis to poke this object over so you can turn. Okay, so we take moment about the axis, which is perpendicular to the paper. Okay, so take moment about axis, and this axis to the force. You have and you get a perpendicular distance. Okay? Okay? So for simplicity, you just say take moment about point, okay? It did. So the point is that how do you find a distance? Okay, a long time. I have a center point here, okay? Moment, force. So how do you find the distance?
Of what?
The distance of each one of the force here. Very simple, okay? The point is that if you have some structures like this kind of things, okay, you have a lot of force, things like that. Do not see this object itself. Do not see it. All you see is the force and the point. Okay? That will be easy. Why? Because if you drop the idea about the rest of the object, okay, you can do this. Extend the force, all you need to do is extend the force, okay? Then you see a line. Then focus on the line and a point, you will know this is perpendicular distance. Very clear, okay? How to get a distance? Extend the force, see the point. Extend the force, see the points. Extend the force, see the point. Okay? Extend the force, see the point. Okay? Extend the force, see the point. Okay, extend the force, the point here, so it's here. Extend the force, okay, see the point. Okay, if it passes through the point, zero. Got it? That's how you get the distance. Sometimes you need to draw out of your the actual physical object inside, which can be very different. Okay? Now, this is the way to find a D. Okay, this way is a guaranteed way to find a D. You can use your own technique, okay? But in case that's too difficult, use this method. Okay? There's another technique, I don't recommend it, but I still want to tell you. Another technique is that if I have a point here, if I have a force here, okay, what do they do? Because they see the objects, okay, kind of things like that, and then they realize, right, the force is in this way, okay? Then what they do, they actually insist in using this distance. Okay, then they will say, I will resolve this force to a components and other components in this way. Okay, that means this component will be here. Okay, then they say this components, right, pass through here, so it's zero. So totally you use this component with this D only. Okay, so use this component and use the D. Can see it? Okay, let's draw a clearer one. Okay. but they give you this distance, they say a force is here, okay? And they say this is theta, okay? Then people will say that...
Most of the time they'll give you the angle.
Yeah, they will give you the angle, right? How to define this.
So it's used sine.
Yes, okay, the idea is that they say this is f sine theta, okay? So they use f sine theta times d, okay? And then the f cosine theta, okay, since it's this one, since it passed through the center, so it's not in effect. It's okay, this method, okay? But as what I say, the best way is to extend the force, see the distance.
Then how do you find it?
Then this 90 degree, right? So this is d, right? Okay? Then if this is theta, you extend this way, this is theta. Okay? So this is d, right? So this is force, right? This is a perpendicular distance.
So it's just a trickle.
So this is actually d sine theta. The same thing. Use d sine theta times force. Okay?
Oh.
Yeah. But this way, you got to see whether this component is in effect or not. Very dangerous. Why? Why is it dangerous? Look at this. Okay. Now it's a big square block. What if I'm talking about this? Oh, okay. What if I'm talking about this force? Okay. The idea is that this horizontal component, vertical component. Yes, vertical component, we can use this. This force and then this distance, right? But the horizontal component in this case, right, you see, you have another effect of horizontal component. You cannot disregard it. Okay? So if sometime you resolve the horizontal component in effect, right, you got to do another one. But why don't I just extend this? Get a D. Okay? So try, I will always recommend not to resolve a force for the moment. Okay? But in some cases like this, it's very difficult.
But this one, if you extend also, you have to...
You can't, you
don't... Not really. You don't see the block, right? They will give you some angle in such a way that you should be able to find easily. Okay? That's my experience. Tell me that.
Because it doesn't form triangle. It's
extend the force in this way. Okay, so this is the distance, right? Okay? So if you have, I don't know, okay, maybe something here, you can actually... This is 90 degrees. So maybe some way they give you some theta, you can actually find the distance straight away.
Oh,
here.
Syllables don't do fat block.
Rigid body. I don't know. Okay. Yes, actually. It may not give you flat block, but it can give you three poles like that.
And some forces you can use the extend force.
But standard? Different things? Okay. Careful, okay. I'm just saying that. There are two ways you can do. You can use this, okay? But be careful. You want to check the horizontal component. Do this. Why not? It's just one and another component. Maybe they give you the height of this. Also can. Okay. So my recommendation is that how to find distance or extend the force. See the point. Don't see the rest. You can find the perfect distance easily. So the second question is that after you find the perfect distance, right? Is the clockwise or anticlockwise? So tell me this is clockwise or anticlockwise?
Clockwise.
This one?
Should be clockwise.
This is a clock, yeah? Clockwise, right?
Yeah.
This one? What do you think?
Clockwise.
This one?
Empty.
This one?
Clock.
Empty. Where is this clock from?
What clock?
This clock.
What do you think?
Just clock.
Clock. Yeah, it's clock.
I think that the clock should be
anywhere. This one, yeah? This one?
Yeah, this one.
Okay, extend this way. Imagine that you hold this, you pull this.
Oh, you hold this.
Yeah, okay, so that's how we imagine this clockwise and clockwise game. So just pull it and pull it, okay, you'll see the potential straight away. Okay, so that's about moment, okay? There's a few names, right? You have moment. Okay, you have torque, you have couples, right? What's the difference between torque and couples?
Couple.
Torque actually is a couple. Sorry? A tuple is coming this way.
I have two folds.
Yeah. Okay, so you normally just use one F and D and they're going to be equal. Why equal? Because a tuple can guarantee translationally no reserve force. That means purely rotation effect. Okay, because these two forces up and down, right, will balance them translationally. That means when your object is in this way, you apply these things, you just rotate. Okay? But if you have these objects, right, you just apply one force, yep, you have movement. Okay? But most probably, right, it will rotate, but it will go to translate also.
If it's a wooden door, then it's hinged on the side. It's just rotational, right?
It's just rotational, yes.
There's no translational. So the normal...
No, it's translation. Sorry. It's translation. Rotation must be about its own center.
It must be the center.
Yeah. It must be a door itself. No, a door in this way, right? Okay. If it is rotating about the center in this way, there's no translation.
Is this considered translational? The door is not at the center.
Not really. Translation, you must have unbalanced forces. So that you can have a net resultant acceleration.
But for the door thing, right,
mm-hmm.
this O is just shifted here only.
Yeah.
So there
isn't, but there isn't a force that will give you a translation. Yeah.
For the door, is it translational?
For the door, is it translational?
Yeah, so, like your laptop, for example, it's hinged to one side, when you move it, is it translational? It's not, right?
Like that, right? Where's another force? Yep, you're right, okay. Just rotation. But in this case, I think it's still called a translation then, for the line.
The axis is at the hinge.
Yeah, because the forces at the hinge, there is not toe. Are you going to call it rotation or translation? Because I see them as a non-repeatable, it's repeatable also, orbiting.
I don't know,
it's borderline, okay? So it depends, when you want to see any translation motion, just see whether all the forces, you have any resultant force or not. Okay? So it can be translated, it can be rotated. Okay, so if you have two forces like that, they balance, so there's no translation. Okay? If you have one up force is longer than the down force, then you have translation. Okay? This case.
If there's a pivot at the direct center, right, then for example it's like that, then we are spinning the pen won't fly off, right?
Yeah.
But if it's here, right, it will tend to move outwards, right? Is that a translation? There's a force that is forcing it to move
it
outwards.
It won't.
Because it's not balanced.
Wait. The reason is that when an object is in rotational equilibrium, the so-called the force between this and the pawn, right? This pawn is up to you to take where the movement is. It's not necessary to be the center of the rotation. Okay, but most of the time we do it, but it's not either. That means you take over, like for example, this is a couple, right?
Mm.
This couple, if you do, this is 4 meters, and this is 2 meters, so the movement is 8. Okay, but if you take movement above center, it is 2-2. So 2-2-2-2 is still 8. If you take movement above here, it's 1-3. 2-1-3-2 is still 8. So actually, you can take movement above any point. So it need not to be the actual rotational center. Okay?
Okay. For it to remain static.
Well, no. When you take movement above rotation, you just take a movement that you want to take. You don't have to take is actual physical rotation center.
Okay.
So in the pen's issues, right? The pen's issue, right? Is that when you rotate, it's rotating about its rotation center by natural. You can't rotate in this way. Unless you have more than this forces at center. Right? Otherwise how you rotate at the time, you have any forces which is not balanced, you have translation. If you have no forces unbalanced, you will have pure rotations. Yeah, still call it rotation, no translation. Right. Okay, so we still call it a rotation, even though it's not center. Okay, that means in this case, even the hinge at the end there, we still call it rotation.
But in this one, right, you, for example,
how's it?
Like for example, you hinge the end of the pen to your finger, then you start swinging the pen around the finger like that. There's a force that causes it to move
upward.
Yeah. So if so, the point is, does it fire out?
If it's just stuck there, but there's a force pulling it outwards, is that considered translation or no?
If it's not fly out, it's still translation. You're right.
If it doesn't fly out,
yeah.
Is it rotation?
It's rotation, yeah. If it doesn't fly out, it's rotation. And no translation. Okay?
How do you find, like, for example, like, how do you find the forces?
Okay. Lateral length 5 meter, mass 2 kg, rest against the wall, its upper end is a height of 3 meters above.
The mass, where to put the mass and the
micro? I think the center of the ladder, makes sense? 5, I don't know, but 5 meter. 2 kg. Rest against the wall, its upper end is a height of 3 meters above.
So the base is 4.
As soon as the wall is moved, but not on the ground, what are the forces on the ladder? Okay.
No, that's
up. Okay, let's first draw the forces, calculate all the variables we have. Okay, the variables here is that this is, okay, now let's replace it with one rule, strip away. One line. Okay, this is 5 meter, so this is 3 meters, so we know this is 4 meters, okay, this is 90 degree, so forces, okay, so 2 kg tells me this is at the center, assume if they didn't say, 20 newton, if you take GS10, okay, forces, okay, at the wall there. The wall is moved, that's what I say. So there's no frictional component, so there's only normal reactions. Okay? In here, you have two forces. Okay, one is the normal reactions from floor, and then there's the frictional force, which is in this way, floor. Okay? So we want to, so what can you say? Okay? The first thing is that translationally they're equilibrium, rotationally they're equilibrium. Translationally, in translations, we talk about the ladder is at rest, so we have the normal reaction on wall equal to the friction on floor. Okay? And normal reaction on floor is equal to the weight. In terms of translation, up force, left force equal to right force, up force equal to down force,
okay,
and one
okay.
Force one ladder. Make sense?
Okay, repeat.
Wait, this is a contact force here.
Yeah.
These two are contact force here.
Mm.
This is the force, conditional force at the center of the ladder.
Mm-hmm.
And these are all the forces on the ladder. The ladder have no other forces.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And the ladder is in equilibrium. So left force, right force balance, up force, down force balance.
Mm.
Okay? So the only left force is this, and only right force is this, so they can be equal.
Also, friction must be equal to.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
The up force must equal to the down force.
Oh, 20 newtons, huh?
Yeah. Okay? Oh, well, in case you see, it's a time 20, anyway. This is 20. So, from here, you straight away say that this is 20. Okay? So, well, find all the forces. Okay? So, what's the next one you're interested in? Now, translation can only give you this information. So, when translation cannot tell you the rest, you do rotation. When you do rotation at time, you take moment about a point and take YSD. Whichever you take moment about it, all the forces that are about that point will be disappeared. Okay? So the wisest one is to take moment about this point. Okay? Then once you take this pawn, right, these two forces will be caught. Okay? Then you only have these two. Because these two pass through this pawn. Uh-huh. You take a moment, this pawn, these two, the clockwise, anti-clockwise moment, or anything will be zero. Okay? So you only left these two forces. And this is an anti-clockwise, and this is a clockwise.
Mm.
Right? Therefore, you can say...
But how do you see the clockwise anti-clockwise? You draw a line.
No,
right?
Same thing. Pawn here, pull this. The whole paper will turn this way. Rotate about this pawn, you pull this force accordingly. The whole thing will go this way. The whole white pawn. Okay? Pawn here, pull down, the whole white pawn will go this way.
Why you pull it?
Sorry?
Why you pull it?
Pull this force.
The 20 Newton downwards force.
Yeah. So this is a rotation center. You pull this down, the whole thing will turn this way. Want me to put it like a nail over here? And then I just rock it this way, and it will rotate this way. Okay? So, clockwise and the clockwise, okay? So, clockwise, force and distance. So, this is 4, right? So, this is 2. Okay? Because it's 50-50, similar triangle, right? Report, okay?
Well,
so, how
do you know that that's 2?
Because this is 4.
Yeah, I know it's 4, but
this
the center of mass is confirmed to 2.
It's not confirmed, but they're not say and take it away, so we can do.
Okay.
Can't do anything like. So let's. This is the distance, right? Perpendicular to the force. Okay, so this is 2. So 20 times 2. Okay.
40.
Equal to n w times 3. And
3 is the horizontal distance.
No, wait. This is the force, right?
Yeah.
This is the pawn, right? So this is the perpendicular distance, right?
Oh.
Okay? As what I say, the easiest way is to extend the force, see the pawn. The pawn and the line only. So you notice the distance. And then so nice extreme does. It will be so nice one. Don't worry.
We use this method if the first method cannot use it.
This one? This method?
Mm.
This method can use, okay? You can get the NF or
the one must you do that?
But you can't have, you can't find these two.
Oh,
okay? But with this one, you can find the NW. Okay? And once you find the NW, you find the FF also. Okay? And these are all unknown there. Okay? Try not to take another moment and do another thing. Okay? Don't have to. Normally, the question will only force you to take one time moment. Don't forget about the translation. Great. So much for a moment. Any more things you want to ask?
Yeah, for sure.
Mm-hmm.
If you see this thing, if there's like two balance and there's this weight in the middle,
mm-hmm.
and the whole length is one,
mm-hmm.
and then they ask you to calculate the moment along some point.
Moment along some point.
Yeah, there's some kind of question.
Moment along some point.
Or moment at some point.
Moment. I think I get what you mean. It's something that can move, right?
Yeah.
Something can move in such a way that something is going to top over the kind of things.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So.
Got two.
I think so. There are always a tool of the support and such. Okay. Where can I? Okay, can't think of that. Let's say have things like this. Okay, and there's a person on top. Okay, and then they say that okay, suppose that this fellow side center. Okay, let's anyhow come with some number. Okay, so they say that the person is, let's say, 70 kg. Okay? The ladder, let's say, is 50 kg and 1 meter. Okay? Then you got to tell you the position. So suppose that from the center, this to this are asymmetrical, and let's say it is 1 meter, so 0.4, well, cannot be. 2.2, what should it be? 2.2, let's say. Otherwise, it will point until the end, it don't drop. Okay? 0.2 meter in the beginning. Okay? So, how long this guy got to walk until the thing start to turn? Okay? This kind of thing, right? Okay? Now, interesting, eh? Think I'm giving myself chump. So, in the force diagram, straight away says that there is a... So, the idea is that you keep walking, there is some... You can start to imagine something. Where will it turn? And when it turn, where is it about to turn?
Just find a distance that will give the clockwise moment that will equal the anti-clockwise moment when the mass is acting at the center.
Yeah,
about but... the pivot.
But it says that how long does it guy walk until it will turn over?
But this one is the same. The anti-clock moment is the same.
Anti-clockwise moment is the same. You only have this, you have the ladder's weight, and you have the person's weight. The person's weight keep going to the right.
Yeah, you don't take the person's weight.
You will take,
just take the ladder's weight.
Take moments of on where?
Take moment about here.
Why not the other side?
Why not an outside there?
Yeah.
So this is why I say you could first imagine what will happen. Okay, wait that. What is your question actually?
Do we just keep the anticlockwise moment as the weight of the ladder times 0.2 equals to the right the clockwise, then we use that one to find distance at the kinetic time?
0.2? No. Because when you walk, okay, when you keep walking, this is not the situation. We keep walking until it, okay, let's follow me again. Then you realize what I want to say. If you keep walking, the ladder will not turn so long as you're still walking in between these two triangles. Mm-hmm. Make sense? And you've got to go over this triangle, and you keep walking some distance, then the fellow will start to, then the ladder will start to turn. And the instant that where the ladder starts to turn, okay, what is the problem? The problem is that where is the center of rotation? Obviously, this is the one.
This is where he goes to the right side.
Oh, I don't know whether it's equal to the right side, but you got to know that these two force up. You have still have two more force. One is here, one is here, right?
You can ignore the left-hand side one, when the thing starts turning.
You can ignore it, but you need it to find answer.
That will be zero already. It's not in contact. Right?
You're right. It's the instant that when it goes zero. So you need it to go to zero, right? So you need something equal to zero. Or the requirement is something got to be bigger than equal to zero. Or less than zero. The equality starts with the end here. Okay? Okay, anyway, when it turns, okay, later you know, okay? When it turns, right, this is the center. Okay? So remember, there are two forces. One force is there, upward. Okay? I call it N1. This is the N2, okay? And most probably your person is here. So you have 700 Newton here. Okay? So you have your weight here. Okay? Which is 100 Newton. Okay? So how do I, of course, when the instant is about to turn, as we say, this is going to be zero. Or should I say it's zero, or it's no longer touching, right? But when it's no longer touching, are they in equilibrium? They're not in equilibrium. So can you form an equation? You can't form an equation. There's no equal sign, no equations. You can't form anything, then you can't solve the issue. Am I correct? What you say is correct, okay? It's really turned already, and it's no longer in an equation. But the point is that if you go until it's already unbalanced, right? We cannot form any equation, cannot find any answer, any number. There's no principle that we can play around with. Correct? So the idea is to keep thinking about, it's about to turn, but not yet turned. So where's the critical moment? The critical moment is about to turn, yet it's not turned yet. So the end is still in the picture, but where is zero? Okay? Then from there, you can find something. The reason is, in general, okay, you take moment of this point. Why take a moment of this point? Because this is the unknown that I don't want to be involved in the equation. I'm interested in this x, okay, which is not this x, okay, which is this x, okay, from this triangle until here, the x, okay? Can I call it another one? I call it
this is
y. Let me call it y, okay? Okay? So, here is 0.2. Make sense? Now here is 0.4. Okay? So let's talk about it in the general case that you haven't turned the things. It's still balanced. Okay? When it's still balanced, in this case, this is anti-clockwise. This is this anti-clockwise is clockwise and this is clockwise. Okay? So then you have 800 times 0.2 equal to 0.4 times n, and then you have plus y.
0.4 times n.
This is the point that you want to take moment.
Yeah.
So n is here, right? So n is here, point is here, the perimeter distance is here. 0.2 both sides, so this is 0.4.
This is the anti-clockwise.
This is the anti-clockwise moment, yeah, you're right, okay? About this point.
Mm.
Okay? So why do you want to take this point? Because I don't want n2 to be in my equation.
What's the clockwise?
Hello? Yes, I am, and who is it? Okay, yeah, it's okay, don't worry about it, okay, I'm busy. Thank you, bye. Free studio shoot, photo shoot. Wow, what happened to me? There's so many miscellaneous people calling me. Okay, anyway, okay, this one, is it okay?
The 800
yep.
times
0.2
is
100 here. 0.2 is here.
This is the because when you your person is at the right side, the thing will go this way.
Yeah, but this is not the person, right?
Yeah, this is the
mass of the panel itself.
Yeah, so this is anti-clockwise.
Yeah, okay,
and
so it's
equal to the clockwise 0.4
and this one, and the y is about
okay, yeah, I know it.
Okay,
yeah,
okay. So we establish an equation, but what is the requirement for it? It's just about the turn. The requirement is that what is the now this is very important physics skill. It's not just about this chapter. It's about your imaginations. How do I write in my paper a way that you can represent the critical moment? You got to imagine. You got to have in mind all the variables. What are the variables in your mind? 1, 2, 3, 4, and the distance. You must have all the number in your mind. Then you start to imagine when this guy keep going to the right. What is the variable that will give you a critical number. You know it, because just now you mentioned it. That is, when the instance that you start to keep walking, when it start to turn, that's the instant that your n will start to get smaller until it goes to zero. Okay? Now, so don't drop that piece of information, because that is the critical one. The whole idea about the critical moment is that at that instant, if the things turn over the instant, your n will go from some value to zero.
When n goes to zero, that whole...
That will start to turn, right? So the idea is that if I want it to turn, I want an inequality. Okay? Because I just don't want it to be equal to zero. Okay? I need an inequality so that I know that y must be lesser than or greater than this, right? Okay? And after that, it will always turn. Okay, so when I say n, if n is positive, that means if my n still have values, will it turn? It will not, right? Because this one is still pressing, right? When the time this is not touching, it is anything not positive. Anything not positive.
It cannot be negative, it must be zero.
And negative will be in an imaginary situation. Remember, in the kinematic then, last question we calculate, t is negative, right? Remember, last lesson in the kinematic, which says that object shoot from here to here, then you take a square, one of you take a square root.
Oh yeah, it's me.
So that you find out the time here, right? Which is not possible, right? But that is what it is. in the imaginary world that it can happen, you just calculate the correct time backward, actually. Okay? And it will give you that velocity, right? Same thing. You'll say that in this case, it will be in touch, therefore, you have it. If you want an inequality, you will say that n, for it to turn over, n is lesser than or equal to 0. Okay? And if you get this inequality sign inside, you will be able to solve your problem. Okay? Take a look at this. Okay? Now, if you're going to use that argument, you're going to first make n as an object first. Okay? Making n as a subject, so n equal to 800 times 0.2 minus y times 700 over 0.4.
Yeah.
You want to turn it over? Convince. Okay? And from there, you drop the n.
Why more than this one must, the value must be more than 0.
More than 0 is not turning.
Yeah.
Alright? You want the y when it turns. Okay? So the n must be lesser than or equal to 0. 0 is about to. Now, from
yeah, n is lesser than.
Okay, wait, okay. When it's not turned,
why
n is positive. When it's about to turn, n is 0. So it's totally gone case already, so less than 0 also can. Think that way.
I don't know your that line n equals 0, then why suddenly got less than 0?
Okay, this is the expression n. Okay. You want to turn over, it is when n is less than 0. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Can?
No.
So I'll write this way better. So, over 0.4, okay? So 0.4 throw away, you know that 800, 0.2 is less than or equal to y 700, right? Therefore, you see y is greater than or equal to 800, 0.2, 700, okay? That means so long as this guy walked to until anywhere greater than this number, this thing will stop turning.
Also, smallest value is there.
Yep, and after you get a y, plus 0.2 is this answer. Got it? Okay, so the idea is that something, critical moment, don't throw it away. You may need to use it. And secondly, try to have an inequality inside. It's always helpful. Okay?
Can we just use the equal and work out?
You can.
Be in the inequality.
You can. And then, by common sense, you know it is. Go further than this value or less than this value. Okay. Can yeah, do that.
Okay.
Yeah, but that's the yeah argument, I don't know. Okay. A way that I argue that these things will happen. Okay. You can use the equal sign to find out the critical moment. Go up. Okay? Easier. I'm just being passive.